And now we start the next talk. And the next speaker is Vera Serganova, University of California, Berkeley, USA. His talk, Similarities Between Representation Theories of Finite Groups of Positive Characteristic and Lie Superalgebras. And now, please share your talk. It's okay.
Okay. Yes. Okay, thank you very much. It's a great honor actually to speak at this conference. And I would like to say that I support Ukraine with all my heart and wish a victory. I would like to talk today about similarities between two different representation theory. It's a representation theory of finite groups and positive characteristics, which I'm not expert at all. And the representation theory of Lie superalgebras, which I'm working long time already, I work with it. So it is a long project, and I have several collaborators on this, Ina and Weisenbad, Alex Sherman, and Dmitry Vanker. So let me, as an introduction, to tell that what are the similarities and what are the differences between representation theory of finite groups in positive characteristics and Lie superalgebras? Of course, when I talk about Lie superalgebras, I'm not talking about all possible Lie superalgebras, but very specific one, and I specify a little bit later which one I consider. So the main important thing which makes the similarities work is the fact that in both cases, we work with symmetric monoidal rigid categories, which are also Frobenius categories. And I will define what does it mean. So in both cases, we have the theory of blocks and defect. And what I'm going to tell to talk today in particular, that we have some analogs of Silo subgroups in the superalgebra case. So in modular representation theory of finite groups, where is a very interesting theory of green correspondences. And basically, we are trying to develop this theory in the Lie superalgebra case. But of course, there are similarities and there are differences. And there are several differences, but I would like to mention only two of them, that blocks in the superalgebra case have infinitely many simples. And what is even more important, but in a classical, in a finite dimensional case, if I induce from a subgroup to a group this factor, and I start with something finite dimensional, when I get something finite dimensional again, and when I work with Lie superalgebras or Lie supergroup, and I consider induction, I get something infinite dimensional. And I actually, this is a good thing, because it actually, if you think about induction in algebraic groups, we are talking about vector bundles and sections of vector bundles. And similarly, in superworld, we have a new interesting geometry which arises from induction. So what I'm going to talk today, mostly I'm going to try to explain the analogs of two results about finite groups. So let us assume that G is a finite group and we work over algebraically closed field of positive characteristic, and we denote by H a Silo subgroup, and by K the normalizer of a Silo subgroup in G. And so there are two theorems which I call A and B, and the theorem A is a particular case of what is called green correspondence. So what I assume here that everybody knows what are in the composable representations, and I might give some background on the other categories, a little bit of background, and a little bit of background on super theory. So suppose now let me return back to these theorems. If M is an undercomposable representations of G over K, and suppose a dimension of M is not divisible by P, when I can take this representation and I can restrict it to K and decompose it into the sum of intercomposable representations, then exactly one representation satisfies the same property, but P doesn't divide the dimension of M0 and all other intercomposable summons have dimension which is divisible by P. And similarly, if I do induction and I start with a representation, it's a decomposable representation of K, M0 here, such that P doesn't divide M0, and I induce when I get back M plus the whole bunch of undecomposable representations of G, such that the dimension is divisible by P. In this way, I actually have a bijection between the decomposable representations of dimension, which is not divisible by P, between G and K. So for people who know tensor category, a little bit of the theory of tensor categories, this pretty easily already implies that the semi-simplification of these tensor categories, which I'm going to define a little bit later what they are, we get an equivalent tensor categories. Do you hear me well? Sorry, is sound okay? Because I hear some echo. Is sound okay now?
Turn off maybe some microphones.
I don't have any. Do you hear echo?
I don't know. I don't hear echo.
It's
maybe.
Okay.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. When I continue. Now let us consider the second result, which is a little bit less general. And this is the following. Let us suppose now that C subgroup is as smallest as possible. Suppose this is just a cyclic group of order P. When if I start with any intercomposable representation, I restrict it to this subgroup K, and when it decomposes into direct sum of intercomposable representation and maybe several projective summons. And similarly, if I do induction. And that means that I actually have bijection between a decomposable which are not projective. And in the language of tensor categories, that means that I actually have an equivalence of tensor categories in of stable categories of G and K. Okay, I explain later what does it mean more precisely. So now I'm going to explain how these results work in Foley superalgebras, but let me start with some generalities. So I'm going to work with symmetric monoidal categories, and I'm going to fix a ground field. So I'm not going to give all the details of the definition. I'm more likely to talk a little bit more about examples, but we assume that our categories are abelian and monoidal, and morphisms between objects are finite dimensional K-vector spaces. An endomorphism of the unit in the monoidal category is just K. And in addition, we have asymmetric braiding. So we have an isomorphism between V tensor W and W tensor V. And this is involutive. If I do it twice, the composition is identity. We have a duality functor, which means what for every object V, we have another object V star satisfying certain natural axioms. This particular means that actually we are talking about rigid categories. We assume that every object has dual. And that allows us to define the notion of trace of any endomorphism and dimension of any objects. And both trace and dimension are actually elements of a ground field. So now the last assumption which I'm talking about, this is assumption that the category is Frobenius. And that basically means that it has enough projective objects, but it also means that it has enough injective objects, because of course, if we have duality, then projective go with injectives and vice versa. So here are our main examples. First of all is the vector spaces. And by vector, we denote all finite dimensional vector spaces with monoidal structure given by natural tensor product of two vector spaces. We can take algebraic group, finite group or algebraic group, and consider representations of algebraic group. And this is of course, again, an asymmetric monoidal tensor categories. But if we work in positive characteristic, the condition, for example, that the dimension is divisible by P, the usual dimension, in the categorical dimension becomes zero, right? Because P is zero in the field. And the example I'm interested in is the example of vector superspaces, which is going to be denoted by S vector. And those are basically Z2 graded vector spaces. So V has a grading V0 plus V1. The main difference with the category of vector spaces is that the braiding between isomorphism between V tensor W and W tensor V is given by this formula, which is written only on homogeneous elements. So V and W homogeneous elements, and V bar and W bar is the parity, zero. So the dimension defined from the categorical point of view is called super trace and super dimension, and they're given by these formulas, namely, dimension is just a difference of a dimension of zero part, even part and odd part, and the trace is the difference of traces V0 and V1, or any linear map, even grading preserving linear map on a vector space. And so here is my next example. We are going to consider the Lie super algebra again. This is a finite dimensional Z2 graded vector space with bracket, which satisfies these two identities. So if you look at the usual Lie algebra, you will see the difference given by this sign change rule, which clearly come from the braiding, which is defined on the previous slide over here. This braiding. Okay, so now we're going to work over C, of course, over any algebraically closed field of characteristic zero, doesn't matter, but let's work over complex numbers. And I would like to say that finite dimensional simple Lie-super algebras, this was maybe beginning of the theory of Lie-super algebras, they were classified by Victor Katz in 77, and it has pretty beautiful list. And the theory started to develop. So maybe I should say one more thing. I would say that, so if I want to define the Lie-super algebra, I have three data. First of all, I have the even part G0, which is the Lie algebra. When I have the G0 module G1, that basically given by the commutator of even and odd element, and I have the commutator bracket, super bracket of two elements in G1 into G0, which is of course invariant. Zero invariant, and it also satisfies this nice identity. So I should mention that we don't have this condition anymore for, say, poorly odd element of the Lie-super. Now, super algebras give us a new example of symmetric monoidal rigid tensors categories. So I can consider representations of superalgebras, and something which I would like rather to talk is algebraic supergroup, but I'm going to do it in the less painful way. So what I can look, I can take a superalgebra and consider some algebraic group such that its Lie algebra is the even part of my Lie super algebra G, okay? And then I can think about the category of representations of the supergroup. So basically I can think about the supergroup G as a pair. Lie super algebra, algebraic group, and the action of an algebraic group, a joint action on the whole G. And then representations of algebraic supergroup would be finite dimensional G0 modules, which meaning that we have modules, G modules, which are integrable to G0 action, to the group action on the even part. So it is pretty straightforward, but what we get again, examples, new examples of symmetric monoidal rigid tensor categories. So here is my main example, and probably the only example which I talk today is, let us start with a supervector space. Dimension of the zero part is M, and dimension of odd part is N. And then we'll consider the Lie algebra of endomorphisms, all linear transformations of V, with the bracket defined by this formula. So basically, if I choose a basis in V, I can think about matrices, block matrices of the size M and N, with even part like this. And odd part like this. So for us, it was very important that we can consider the only even part, and this is a sum of two general linear Lie algebras, and the square Poisson algebraic group is just a product of two general linear groups. So people very soon discovered, actually Victor Katz already mentioned it in, discussed this phenomenon in his paper, that representations of simple Lie super algebras, almost never semi-simple, finite dimensional representation, in contrast with the Lie algebra case. So basically there is only one series of simple Lie super algebras which have semi-simple finite dimensional representation theory. And we can of course take products of such there are examples of such superalgebras and usually algebras, and nothing more appears. So now I would like to discuss a little bit what does it mean that Reb G, the category of representations of algebraic supergroup, what does it mean that this category is Frobenius? So again, I remind you that now we work in characteristic zero, and then it's not very difficult to check, but if G is an algebraic group, and it's with, such that its category of representation is Frobenius, then G must be reductive, and therefore representation theory is semi-simple. However, if G is an algebraic supergroup, then representation, the category of representations is Frobenius, so it has enough projectives, already, so it has enough finite dimensional projective, if and only if it's zero part, G0, the algebraic group, real, honest algebraic group sitting inside, is a reductive group. So we call such supergroup quasi-reductive. And so the main reason behind this second statement is that if I take and consider induction factor and I induced from the even part, and I induced from finite dimensional representation, I end up again in a finite dimensional category. And so if I start with something which is projective, I induce and I still have something finite dimensional, and it is projective in my category. Now, let me go a little bit further and switch the gears and talk now a little bit about two constructions, which I already announced, related to tensor categories, which we discuss. In fact, the first construction, semi-simplification, is defined in much more general setting, but at the moment, we will talk only in our situation. So semi-simplification is a sort of universal way to start with the tensor category, which is not semi-simple, and construct canonically a semi-simple category. And so what we do, we take a quotient of our category by the ideal of negligible morphisms. And here is a definition of the negligible morphisms. So you remember we have a trace, and so we say the morphism is negligible. Whenever I compose it with morphism in the opposite direction, the resulting morphism has categorical trace zero. Okay, so when I take this quotient, that means I consider the same set of objects, but morphisms are quotient by the ideal of negligible morphisms. So what we get here is a semi-simple category with natural factor from C to C star, which has some universality property. I would like to skip it just in interest of time. Simple objects in this new category, C bar, the same as in the composables in C of non-zero categorical dimension. So one important remark, that if characteristic of K is zero, and we start with an algebraic supergroup, usual algebraic group, including, and consider the semi-simplification of our category, when what we get would be again the category of representation of certain reductive supergroup. Only it might be pretty huge group. It's what is called a pro-algebraic group. It's something a bit bigger than just algebraic groups. So this thing here might be called, is sometimes called a reductive envelope. So it's very important to say that this argument, this result doesn't work a positive characteristic. And in particular, I probably think that Ettinghoff is going to talk about it in his talk, the last talk at this conference. I'm not talking right now about this. I'm talking about the characteristic zero case. So in the second construction, is a stable category. suppose in addition that our category is Frobenius, so we construct the tensor, stable category, which we denote C stable, again as a quotient, but now we quotient by the morphisms which pass through any projective object, which can be morphisms, which are compositions to projective and from projective object. So this category has a monoidal structure, but it's not abelian anymore. It is a triangulated category. Now, I would like to study all this in the situation of quasi-reductive supergroups. And my one example, which I would like to discuss, is the supergroup GEL-1-1. Let us think about it. Let's look at the corresponding algebra. And it has four elements, X, Y, which are odd, also two odd elements. The commutator is actually XY plus YX, is a scalar matrix, C, which lies in the center. So in a way it behaves like a Heisenberg algebra, only the super Heisenberg. And I have another element, which I call grading. This is H. So if I have an suppose I would like to, so the point is that this category is still tame category and can describe in decomposable representation. So the C is a central element. And let's also remember that we are in the group situation. So Cx by scalar lambda, where lambda is actually an integer because it must be representation of gel one. So if lambda is not zero, then it's not difficult to see that M is simple and projective and X, so you can think about it like X going. So the basis consists of two vectors, one even, one odd, and action of X and Y should be clear from this picture. If lambda is zero, then we can quotient by the center and consider the quotient group, PGL-1-1, and it's also tame category. It's related to infinity. It is equivalent to A infinity quiver. Satisfying these relations of the quiver. This is a very old result. Obtains representations, decomposable representations of this sort were classified many times in different settings. And in particular, they appear here when we study representation theory of PGL-1-1. And what I would like to say that the semi-simplification of this category is known. I think first this was computed by Thurston Heidersdorf. And it is just representation theory of two, a product of two multiplicative group of the fields. So in our case, I should say, this is representations of C star cross C star. So this is my reductive envelope in this case. Okay, so now I think I did enough on introduction and I'm very quickly, I'm supposed to go to the main results. So let me start with the definition of a splitting subgroup. So here we assume that both K and the subgroup supergroups we are talking about are quasi-reductive. And I induce from the trivial representation, then I clearly have natural map from the trivial representation to the induced module. And I call the group splitting and there is the map in the opposite direction. So C is a direct summand. In the induced module. So there is an equivalent, a few equivalent definitions. For example, that means that all X group, when I do the restriction map on X groups between over G and over K, this map is injection, which basically means when whenever I have a short exact sequence of G modules, which splits over K, then it splits over G as well. So here is an example. Suppose G is a finite group. Then it's not very difficult to see that the group K is splitting if and only if its index is not divisible by P. Or in another form, K contains a PCO subgroup. And indeed, it's not very difficult how to construct the splitting because I can just take the average over left cosines of G mod K. So I take the average. And so if I have a splitting here, I can take an average and obtain the splitting over. So what is important is that if we have a splitting subgroup, when the negligible morphisms under restriction functor map to negligible morphism, and hence we do have a functor between semi-simplification. So it is clear that we would like to do this problem. We would like to describe splitting subgroups for quasi-reductive supergroups. Well, so here, co-geometry comes into the picture. So G mod H is actually some object which is in fact supermanifolds, right? And induced. It's just a supercommutative ring of functions on this supermanifold. So we don't quite understand in general the structure of G module here on this algebra. So let me just give you a few results very quickly. So we have important necessary condition for splitting. We consider specific odd elements in the Lie algebra such that this commutative of itself is a semi-simple in G0. You remember that G0 is a reductive, so this is well defined. When to each such element, they are very important. To them, I can associate specific tensor functors from representations of G to representations of some smaller Lie superalgebras. So they are very important, but unfortunately, I don't have much time to talk about them. So one of the first theorem we have, if K is a splitting subgroup in G, then we have a necessary condition that for any, we call such elements homological, that's why we have it here, but for any homological element, if I pick up any homological odd element and I consider the joint orbit of corresponding reductive group, it must intersect K. The proof is very simple. Actually, not exactly simple because it involves some geometry, but if such orbit intersection is simple, then this factor must be identically zero, but if C is a direct summand, if C is a direct summand, it couldn't be because clearly application of this factor to the trivial module is not zero. Okay. Now, sufficient condition. Here I will be very brief. So the main idea is I would like to take the average, but now I'm in continuous situation. So I would like to use the unitary trick. I would like to integrate. But here we come to a lot of problems. We have to study the integration theory on supermanifolds. And that involves a lot of results. It involves volume force, Bayesian integrals, compact cos cycle. So because I would like to integrate over something, fortunately, I would like to integrate over something compact to get some finite number, sufficient to consider the even part of my supermanifold, consider the compact real form. There is a formalism of such integrals, which was developed by Witten, Bernstein, and others. So what I would like to do, actually, I would like to take an invariant volume form, and I would like to integrate, and I get a number, right? And if W is invariant, then I do have a map, this map, right? The map I'm looking, this map here. I'm going to get this map here. Well, the point is how to compute. That's what we call the volumes, actually. Right? We want to see if the volume of our object is not zero. And so, and there was a very beautiful work of Schwartz and Zaporonsky, which allows us to compute the integrals using odd vector fields on supermanifold. And with Wittgenstein-Weintraub, we have to generalize it to CS situation. But basically, we can do it. We can say when the volume is not zero. And that gives us, we can describe splitting subgroups for all quasi-reductive simple superalgebras. We call them defect subgroup. I'll just give you an example here. Suppose I have GLMN. When inside it, and I assume that M is less or equal to N. When inside it, I could put several copies of SL11, as many copies. Maximum is M, right? So here is the situation I was trying to show you. So in this little shaded squares, we can have any numbers. This is on the Lie algebra level, of course. And here we have little GL N minus M. So this is conjecturally the smallest splitting subgroup. So we take now the normalizer of this defect subgroup. So in our example, this is actually not connected supergroup anymore. I have to make here correction. So it's a semi-direct product, symmetric group with M product of M copies of GL11 and a product of GLN minus M. So we have the theorem. This is the theorem of, sorry, I didn't write, but Alex Sherman at E9 of Eisenberg, that if M isn't decomposable and superdimension of M is not zero, then I restrict it. And exactly like in the situation in a finite group, I have one in the composable, exactly one in the composable sum whose superdimension is not zero. So the corollary is that I have a faithful factor from representation between semi-simplification of G and semi-simplification of K. But here we encounter the problem. We cannot prove a similar result for induction, and it's actually not true. So in general, this functor is not essentially surjective. But there is a situation. So basically that's what I wanted to say about the first result, how we generalize this first result, result A, about finite groups. Now, for the second one, we consider so-called defect one supergroups, where this splitting subgroup is just SL11, for example. This is the list of such simple defect one P superalgebras. There is the result of Shermanin that representation theory of G is tame if and only if G has a defect one. And our theorem is that in this case, we not only have an equivalence of semi-simplifications, we only have an equivalence of the stable categories. And this generalizes the second result, which I mentioned in the first in the beginning of the talk. And so here I can stop. I just would like to say some open problems. First, we really would like to understand this in general and understand what the image of this factor. Next, we would like to show that the supergroups, defect supergroups we constructed, we would like to show that we always have the minimal unique up to conjugation, minimal splitting subgroup, which is our analog of Silo subgroup. And of course, what is desirable to do more advanced, look at more advanced results from representation theory, from modular representation theory of finite groups, and try to generalize them for supergroups. And thank you very much for your attention. I'll stop here. Sorry, I might run over time a little bit. Excuse me.
Thank you.